some of my close friends said that I was a late bloomer in psychiatric research, you know? And I think that Steve is the opposite. Steve is an early bloomer in research. So he spent the whole morning with us looking at my research and Juan's research and Chris Abbott's research, and he got us thinking a lot more. So Steve is senior associate dean of research, and Stanley and Mickey Kaplan professor and chairman of psychiatry and behavioral neuroscience at the University of Cincinnati College of Medicine. And he's also appointed a professor of psychology and biomedical engineering. So I had the pleasure to visit Steve several years ago, and I was impressed with the setup that he has there and that he had developed over the years. Steve went to medical school in Vanderbilt and then did his psychiatry residency training at McLean Hospital in Boston. He has more than 250 peer-reviewed publications, has had many grants, and he has a great team working for him and working with him, and he's going to enlighten us today about bipolar disorder, and so I hope that you enjoy his talk. Thank you.
Thanks, Jose. When he said he was a late bloomer, I thought he was going to say I was an early burnout, but I wasn't sure where it was going exactly. All right, so I'm going to talk about this organ. So this came out in Time magazine, I think in 2005, I can't remember now, somewhere in there. And these kinds of publications are always disconcerting when you're in a field as a scientist. So Time in 2005 declared it had solved the problems of what caused bipolar disorder in the brain. Like I said, we had a lot of work funded still working in that, so it was a little disconcerting that Time had figured it out. But it turns out they hadn't, but they had at least had some thoughts. And I just like to put this up for non-imaging audiences, which I assume not all of you are brain imagers, right? There are at least one that's not. To remind us what we're looking at as we go through looking at some of the imaging data. And so there are some things that Time said that I think are probably true, and that bipolar disorder involves some of these key areas. And so the amygdala, as you remember, is kind of buried deep inside your brain, and it really serves a primary, very, very basic function. Does anybody remember what that is? What's the amygdala do? Why do we have one? Why do lizards have at least streaks of one? Right. It's a fight or flight responder, right? Its job is to motivate the organism to get away from, either defend itself or get away from danger. And so we have one too. And in animals, you see those responses, fight and flight. In people, we see them, but they are nuanced heavily. And they're nuanced heavily into emotional responses. And so you get arguments or pedantic academic discussions, which often have nothing to do with the discussion point, but are emotional threat management techniques, right? So when you and your chair are talking about your salary, you digress into these things that are really just threat management. And that's all managed in humans by this chunk of brain here. And I always like to ask the question, what physical characteristic separates humans, external physical characteristic, truly separates you from the rest of the animal kingdom? Anybody? You have a big forehead, right? There are other animals with opposable thumbs. There are lots of animals that stand on two legs, but there's nobody else with a big forehead. Elephants look like they have a big forehead, but it turns out it's just a fat pad on the top, which may be true for some of the humans too. But that, you know, you don't see animals with big foreheads. Even our closest kin, the chimpanzees, have a slopey forehead. And in fact, evolutionarily, and why do we have a big forehead? Well, it's to protect this just enormously overgrown prefrontal cortex that no other species has. And even we as Homo sapiens didn't really have until about 50,000 years ago. And there was this great leap forward that was associated with a massive growth of prefrontal cortex. So what's the function of this thing? Well, what's the most dangerous and rewarding thing in the environment of human beings? Anyone? Sex. Same thing. What is it?
Sex.
That's so primitive, doctor. I won't repeat this one. In the back, correct. Other human beings, right? That's where you get your greatest rewards. That's where you get, who murders women? Their husbands, right? 90% of the time. The biggest threat, and hopefully who's your best emotional contact? Your wife. So the biggest threat and the biggest reward is the people sitting next to you. And so what made us successful, we're not, in the animal world, we're not very fast, we're not very strong. Some would argue we're not. My dean, when I graduated from medical school, was pretty sure dolphins were smarter than medical students, and probably was right. But what we did in that great leap forward is suddenly we developed a critical mass of humanity to work as a groups and become dominant. And we are dominant in the planet. And so this big chunk of material didn't evolve so you could do math problems. It didn't evolve so you'd be good at writing literature. It evolved so you could manage your psychosocial environment. And the spin-off, fortunately, is it allows you to do math problems and balance your checkbook and all that other stuff. And so this big chunk of brain is uniquely human and is heavily innervated and integrated into the limbic system based in the amygdala and other structures I'll talk about in a second. And all of that allows us to manage our emotional states. And as you know, in bipolar disorder, that's failing. And so we don't have to do any more work to know where the problems are in bipolar disorder, but I'll show some data so that I show you that I don't make up everything I say. Ventral striatum is a way station. So the way the prefrontal cortex is set up, it's actually not one chunk. It's a bunch of truly different heterogeneous regions that don't have that much to do with each other at the level of the prefrontal cortex, but then loop through all these regions have these similar designs where they map onto specific areas of the striatum, the thalamus, and pallidum, and then cycle back. And so they create these free forward and feed forward and feed back loops from the prefrontal cortex with their specific areas they manage that allow us to iteratively manage our behavior. And so I like to use the example, which again probably has no basis in reality, but who's seen the Terminator movies? Anybody? I'm dating myself partly. The first Terminator movie, there's a scene where there's a guy banging on Arnold the cyborg's door, and you see him cycling through all the possible responses. Do you remember that? And he inevitably picks the most aggressive one, and that's how he responds. But that's what this does. This takes all this information, it iteratively manages it and guides your behavior. And this is a complete speculation that has almost no base in reality. But when someone sits too close to you and you have these fleeting ideas of what you might do, most of which you choose not to do, right? You don't punch them, you don't kiss them, you don't ask them out, you move over a seat or something. That's your brain quickly working through choices. Is that really true? Probably not, but that's how I think of this structure working. And so this part of the brain iteratively manages all of the sensory input. And the prefrontal cortex gets processed sensory input from all the sensory organs. And then it also gets a lot of accessory input. It really coalesces it. That's what makes us uniquely human. It's also one of the struggles of developing animal models in psychiatric conditions, because animals don't have a massive overgrown prefrontal cortex. There's an old book by Kurt Vonnegut called Galapagos. I don't know how many of you read that, where it's a future where humans' prefrontal cortex has gone back down to the size of seals, and they're much happier, by the way. And so that's something to think about. Striatum I talked about. Hippocampus, I don't know why Time put this in here. It's closely linked to the amygdala. That's probably not an accident of just happened to be a convenient place someone could put it. Your emotional tone impacts how you make memories, and that makes sense. As an organism who wants to survive, you don't need to remember every banal, boring thing that happened to you, but you do need to remember those things that were either exciting, positive, or scary. But it probably, in our research in bipolar disorder, has tended not to be, to look like it's particularly unusual or different in bipolar people, other than how perhaps it modulates the emotional system. And finally, I also am not clear why the brainstem was identified, other than the fact that there's serotonin receptors that come through here, or serotonin's made here that is proliferated around the whole brain. But so is dopamine, and so is norepinephrine, and these widely dispersed neuromodulators, which is what monoamines really are, all come from here, and it's not clear if that's where there's a primary lesion or not. And so most of what we think is happening in the bipolar brain is happening here. And if you want, you can leave, because that's pretty much it. But I'm now going to go through and talk about some of the findings. Any questions or comments so far? It's just my setup slide. See, there's a prefrontal failure there. So because that's too hard to do in day-to-day brain imaging thinking, and partly because I was an engineer and this is how engineers think, we've worked out a network of systems. This is sort of a schematic of how emotions might be expressed. And again, if we view bipolar disorder as primarily a disorder of emotional modulation and control, which I think is accurate and true, somewhere in here there's a problem. And so back to the brain we talked about. So these are those loops I talked about. And it turns out that in the way the human brain is organized, most of the emotional and social modulation in the prefrontal cortex is located in its ventral components. All right, so your ventral brain manages how you feel, how you respond to how you feel, and how you interact with other feeling creatures, the people around you. And there's the orbital frontal cortex and ventral frontal cortex, and one kind of manages internal emotional states, and one the other kind of manages external emotional cues, and then presumably they integrate, probably not in the prefrontal cortex, but at the level of the striatum and thalamus. These then form loops that are mapped onto the striatum. These are really separate, so I could have put two series, but there was no room in the slide. Pallidum, thalamus, and back. And these feed forward and feedback loops provide that iterative control. And those of you interested in glutamate is rife through here. Glutamate and glutamine are the predominant neurotransmitters in this system. In fact, most of the glutamate in the human brain is located prefrontally. The amygdala is I kind of think of as a thermostat that sets a tone of emotional, or that one, except that I'm right-handed, it's easier. Emotional tone is set by this organ. This is the fight-flight responder, and that's still what it's doing with people. But it's heavily innervated both directions into these prefrontal networks that then modulate that emotional response to allow you to manage your emotional responses so as to avoid trouble and hopefully be successful. The anterior cingulate sits in a very interesting position where it's as you start in the most subgenual part, which is kind of the below the corpus callosum, and then work your way back posteriorly, it goes from mostly emotional modulation and management to increasing cognitive management because this is mapping into it that way. The low ventral part of the prefrontal cortex maps low and then it maps around. And so some people, many think that then this part of the brain is used to integrate a lot of these different components, cognitive, emotional components. And the cingulate's known to be involved in dealing with conflicts and problem solving. So the old Stroop test is the classic where you're told to name the color of the ink when the word is discordant, and the cingulate always lights up to help you suppress the overlearned reading to name the color. It also then is this intersection where we currently think that the ventral prefrontal cortex intersects with the dorsal prefrontal cortex and then reciprocally interact. And so all of you know this from experience. This has been shown in imaging. When the mood system's on, the ventral prefrontal cortex is on, the dorsal tends to go quiet, and the converse is true. So you know that. When you're really upset, you don't pay attention very well. You can't solve problems very well, and that's when we often make dumb, impulsive decisions. On the converse, the whole basis of cognitive behavioral therapy is that you can outthink your emotions and sort of drive them back to normal state, which is physiologically true in that as you overuse your dorsal prefrontal cortex, you decrease the activity in your emotional cortex. Does that make sense? All that's to say, though, is the two are not disconnected, and so it's almost impossible to have a disorder of emotion that has no cognitive components or a disorder of cognition that has no emotional components. And think about it for a minute, right? A cognitive illness like Alzheimer's, as you know, often has rife emotional pieces to it as it goes through the course of illness. Finally, this is not a great Valentine's Day card, but love is no more than an autonomic response driven by your hypothalamus, which doesn't make a, dear, you are a hypothalamic overdrive for me, right? It's not as romantic as love. All our feelings are the feelings we have come through this part of the brain that activates autonomic systems to give us a physical sensation to match our cognitive emotions. And so that comes, it's actually more complicated, but I got tired of drawing arrows. But it gets input from lots of these pieces, but in particular amygdala. And then ultimately all these things come together. Actually, the STG is involved with this modulation too. I'm not going to talk about that a lot, but for your interest, it's interesting. All of this comes together to have for you to process, manage, and express emotion. And if you're lucky and you got the right set of genetics and your parents weren't really terrible, you do this reasonably well because this is how you get through your day. Human beings are emotional animals. They really aren't, we are not inherently logical. And so we make most of our decisions emotionally. And so we rely on these systems to make those decisions. What's the practical reason for making emotional instead of logical decisions? It's faster. And it's no more complicated than that. If you're thinking about the lion charging your troop and all the possible pros and cons of moving, while the people who are scared just dart, what happens to your ability to reproduce after the lion? It goes down. So this system then are critical for our ability to adapt and live in our world. So I'm going to talk about some imaging data that supports this stuff. So this is a study we did probably in the mid-90s, and eventually gets published in 1999 and was published in the archives, where we were starting to think about what this network that we and others have called the anterior limbic network. Not a particularly creative name, but that's what it is. And we were interested in saying, okay, if there's abnormalities here, can you actually see them structurally? Now, why were we using structural imaging in the mid-90s rather than something cooler like fMRI? Anyone? So we didn't have fMRI. So one of the important things to remember in science is it's always driven by its tools and always limited by its tools. And so part of the dopamine hypothesis power was that was all Saul Snyder could measure at the time, right? So you got to keep that in mind, that we never really know everything. And so we were looking at structural imaging, even though it's not clear how much that would help, but finding something there would be useful. And so we looked at the areas we talked about. Back then, we weren't able to break the prefrontal cortex very well into pieces, so we just did a big slab, and that so big it's divided by 10, that's what that means. And the thalamus, striatum, pallidus, and amygdala. Reviewers made us do these two things at the end. We didn't want to. We weren't interested. We thought it was a distraction from what we were trying to do, but we had to publish the paper, so we did these. And we compared bipolar folks that were stable. These were manic folks at time of admission, and healthy volunteers who were matched to them sociodemographically. We fortunately have a setup where we really pull all of our healthy and patient samples from the same general population areas in our city. And we found something that in psychiatry was an unusual finding at the time, that in the bipolar in red, that the striatum, pallidum, and amygdala were all different, and they were all larger than the patients. And really, up till this time, historically, typical findings had been that psychiatric patients exhibited reductions or loss of tissue. And so that was unusual, and it suggested that something was going awry throughout the network, not just in one brain region. And this was also a time in psychiatry where there was a tendency to try to localize mental illness into a single structure. That's not going to happen because the brain isn't organized that way. And so we were trying to look at a network approach. The thalamus just missed, as you can see, and the prefrontal cortex measure was too gross to be useful. Hippocampus was not different, and for a little while our group and the UCLA group thought that the difference of versus schizophrenia, which typically shows a small hippocampus and often a small amygdala, that combination might be a really interesting distinction. It's not clear if that's true now, though, and other work since then suggests that lithium exposure might increase amygdala volume. And so there's been some trouble replicating that finding in adult patients. But regardless, this helped support this initial notion that within this system, something's developed funny, right? The brain is funny, although maybe it's just treatment exposure. I can't remember what I have. In contrast, if you look at pediatric populations, and this has both child studies and adult studies. Here's adult, here's child. Whereas the adult, there's some variability that's probably reflecting differences in treatment exposure and other confounds. The kids, with this one exception, one or two, directionally, they're always smaller. And so is it possible that both these things are true, that you have small amygdalas in bipolar young people as the illness is starting, and then it's bigger if you study adults later. Is that possible? It could be. It could be an artifact of treatment exposure. It could be that this is a developmental condition. And a good example is autism. When they're two, the kids have bigger brains than almost any other two-year-old, but they're disorganized brains. And then they prune funny, and they end up with small brains, right? But there's a developmental process that leads to an initial overgrowth and then a subsequent pruning abnormality. And so this has continued to be found, that in bipolar young people, the amygdala is smaller, whereas typically in more older patients, it's either normal-sized or enlarged. That makes sense? So we've tried to look at this by following teenagers with bipolar disorder over time. And so, and for comparison in this study, this was published last year, or 2 years, what is this, 13, 2 years ago. These are about, they're 12 to 15, 16-year-old kids. Very early in their course of bipolar illness. And we made amygdala measurements at baseline, and then we followed them 12 months later. The green dots are healthy subjects. We used an ADHD control because there's such a amount of, there's such a confound in symptoms between ADHD and mania and hypomania in kids. And we also wanted a psychiatric control group that was common to see, is this unique to bipolar disorder, is this just a general finding of being exposed to psychotropics and being mentally ill? And so they're the red dot, and then the bipolar kids are the blue dots, and then the same thing, this is left, this is right. So the normal process at this point is for healthy kids' amygdalas to grow during this phase. And so it turns out, do any of you have adolescent children? Or have you had? So it turns out that it's normal that there's a great deal of changes in brain structure during the adolescent years from about 15 to 21 or 2 in girls, maybe a little earlier, 13 to 22, and about 15 to 25 in boys. So if the girls have always wondered, all the 22-year-old girls have always wondered why the boys their age seem like children, it's because they physiologically are. Right? So you're okay. You're right in that observation. And then the way I talk to my kids, so the amygdala is going to grow and then it's going to taper down, and the prefrontal cortex is going to start tapering down as it gets better organized and presumably more efficient. And so I've always told my sons, who are 18, 21, that they have adult appearances, but their prefrontal cortex has them at the level of chimpanzees, right? So barely functioning, and they think I'm stupid, but that has changed as they've gotten older, so that's part of it. And so this trajectory suggests that something's gone awry in these kids during this first year following a manic episode, that the normal developmental process is failing. And so this is some evidence suggesting to us that the evolution of bipolar disorder is a progressive process. And we think it may be later, if we could follow these kids long enough, that we'd see it eventually tail back up and go some sort of disorganized growth that takes it above normal development. A similar sort of thing, this is a study, this was a result of the reviewers forcing us to look at lateral ventricles in our study. And one of the things we then broke up into is looked at lateral ventricle volumes in healthy subjects, first episode and multiple episode patients who were all about the same age. The ventricles themselves are uninteresting, right? They're spaces, so there's not that much going on in the ventricle itself. But a growth or expansion or enlargement of a ventricle is interesting because of the matter surrounding it. And sure enough, we found something interesting. The first episode sample had almost completely normal looking ventricular volumes. In fact, the one healthy subject was the outlier from that entire group. In contrast, the multiple episode patients were all over the map, although the mean is above the biggest of the other group. So it's truly a unique separation. And that turned out to associate with the number of prior manic episodes. So we looked around the tissue and looked at the gray matter pieces that make lateral ventricles, and those were enlarged, as we showed earlier. And so that wasn't contributing to this. And so this was some early evidence. We thought that there's some loss in white matter volume around ventricles associated with recurring affective episodes that's causing this progression in people as they proceed through their illness. An alternative interpretation of this could be that if you have big ventricles and insufficient white matter at the onset of mania, then you're going to have more episodes and you're more likely to land in a multiple episode sample, and that is completely possible here. The evidence against that, though, is the complete complete lack of anyone in the first episode group that's enlarged, and so we think it's probably a progression rather than a predictor state. Does that make sense? And we think it's white matter changes. So this is a work from the Pittsburgh group, and they've done a lot of DTI kind of work, trying to understand the white matter components in bipolar disorder. Again, if you think about the white matter tracts that go around the ventricles, they're the ones that make up those iterative networks I talked about earlier. And so there's a kind of a story that's coming together here. And in their work, they found a couple of things. On the left, they see abnormalities. They see greater fractional anisotropy, meaning that it's more organized than in healthy folks. And then on the right, they see less, greater diffusivity, and it's more disorganized. And so there seems to be even a lateralization of developmental abnormalities in the onset and course of bipolar disorder. And they've also shown that these are kids at risk who have bipolar parents, and they've looking at trajectories of development over time in these measurements. And the control trajectory is to, and this is, I can't read up here, so I can't remember. FA goes up in the healthy people, right? Because it gets more organized. And this must be diffusivity here, right? I can't see it. Diffusivity goes down because you become more organized in healthy kids. So this is the normal progression. And the bipolar at-risk kids who don't yet have illness are already showing a reverse pattern or a flat pattern in their development of their white matter tracts in their prefrontal cortex and temporal regions, right? And so again, it's suggesting that there's the developmental progressive process even before the illness starts, which makes sense. Again, bipolar disorder, as you probably know, is 85% heritable. And so these genes are present the day you're born. They don't later show up. And so it's almost certain that it's impacting brain development throughout the course of your life. And as you get into adolescence, as these major changes start occurring, they seem to be the changes that set you up for getting a bipolar illness, ultimately a disengaged prefrontal cortex that loses control of your emotional network. Make sense? But these aren't the only studies, and there's been a number now in bipolar disorder that show progressive changes in prefrontal cortical volumes and the cerebellar vermis, which is really interesting, and I don't have time to talk about a lot, but the cerebellum is often thought of as a motor structure that does little else, but it turns out what it really is an error detecting system that's plugged into these reverberating networks, and it checks for error response, which is what happens in disorders of cerebellum, or can't do that anymore, and so you can't move smoothly. We think it's doing probably the same thing in the mood networks. It's just the output's not a shaky finger. It's shaky emotions, if you will. And that's been shown to be smaller as episodes accumulate. Amygdala I've talked about already, and ventricles I talked about. And so there's an accumulating evidence that there are these progressive changes in the anatomy of people at risk for and early in the course of bipolar disorder. So this is not a suddenly coming out of the blue illness. It's been built up to, and then it progresses over time. That's not new information. In fact, all I've done is told you something that Emil Kraepelin told us in 1921, that this is a progressive illness. I like this. This is one of my favorite slides of all time, because this is from 1921, and this is from the NIH when Peter Roybern did bipolar work before switching to anxiety, and now he quit all of it because he got sick of academics and is treating patients, for those of you who know Peter. These guys had no medicines. They were in state or whatever, the equivalent of state facilities in Germany. These guys are a lot of NIH patients who are these bizarre, very difficult to find, highly ill, overly treated patients. And despite those dramatic differences in the samples, the findings were the same. So this is the interval number between episodes. So number one is the interval between your first manic and your second affective episode. Two is between that episode and the next one. Does that make sense? So each one of these is the interval between the episodes. And this is well known and has been described by Jules Angst and now many, many times, that early in the course of bipolar disorder, through about the first five episodes, there's this continual decline in well time, whether that's with no treatment or with Western modern medicine. It seems to still be occurring, which suggests that we may not yet have figured out how to stop this thing from progressing. We think, so all those anatomic changes I was showing you, I think is the physiological basis for this progression in the early course of illness, while a recurring manic illness is getting set up that then becomes a lifelong condition. And one of our research goals is to try to interrupt this progression somewhere earlier in this course to prevent that. All right? So we hypothesize that this clinical phenomenon is based in progressive brain physiology. Now, what we can't tell you is there's some debate, are the episodes causing the damage? Maybe. And so that's the part we have to decide, what's coming first and what's leading to what. All right. Any comments or questions? The fact is, in psychiatry, we've yet to really demonstrate, and I think in virtually anything, that we impact the long-term outcome of patients. And so we still have to keep developing our treatments. So I'm going to now diverge into functional imaging. You all have seen these kind of slides now. They're all over. We throw up a structural imaging slide. And this is the brain cut this way, right? This is the front. This is the back. These are the ventricles I talked about, prefrontal cortex. And then we superimpose activation measurements, which are really changes in hemoglobin that MRI detects. So MRI hemoglobin, depending on whether it's got an oxygen bound to it or not, is magnetically different. And so the more oxygen that's bound, the brighter the magnetic signal is, kind of a shorthand version of a complex physical process. And so what we see is areas that are activated have excessive oxygen. So the brain, it's sort of different than what you would predict. You'd predict that when you use it more, the oxygen level would go down, right? Because you're using it more. But the way the brain's designed is it's really an energy hog, and it takes excessive blood flow. And so more blood flow will come into an active area than is needed to manage the activation. And that's what causes MRI. And so this measurement, and so with bold measurements, as this is called, what you're really seeing is changes in oxygenation levels. You're not actually seeing neurons activate. And as far as we know, it could be glia that are causing some of this. It probably is. So this is a study then. So we took what we've learned from the structural imaging, and we're trying to now understand this network better. And I showed you guys, some of you guys, this earlier, so I apologize. But this is a simple study where we were going back to this notion that if the ventral and dorsal prefrontal areas reciprocally interact, that if there's something wrong in the emotional system of the bipolar folks, it's going to affect their cognition. But we also knew that, particularly when euthymic, patients actually function quite normally. They're doctors and lawyers and CEOs and everything else in between, teachers. And so we were interested is, could you take a simple task that you expect them to do well and still notice possibly this interference coming from overactivation in the emotional brain that might be interfering with the cognitive brain? And so this was a fairly, I'm going to show you the task in a second, but the hypothesis was that the anterior limbic network, the emotional brain, was going to be inappropriately activating during a non-emotional task and potentially disrupt the task. We had a unique sample in that we had been doing a long-term outcome study of first episode manic kids, mostly. They're mostly teenagers. And as you might predict, how many of you think that these kids will stop their medicine sometimes? Right. So again, back to the Kreplin slide. So if I'm a manic kid and they see me, or someone looks like me, and I tell them the facts. The facts are, if you've had a manic episode, you have about an 80% chance of having a bipolar course of life. That's the reality. But if I'm 18, where am I going to put my bet? On the 80% of being ill? Of course not. And they shouldn't. I think that would be unhealthy. I actually think it's a healthy adolescent response to hope that I'm not one of the 20%, that this was a fluky thing and it's never going to happen again. And so virtually all these kids stopped their medicine at some point. But the good news is, because we paid them a few bucks and they like getting brain scans and we're actually generally pretty friendly, they kept coming in and were able to follow them up. And over time, we accumulated these kids who had virtually no symptoms for weeks. They were willing to get scanned. And so this is true euthymia. They had at least 4 weeks of virtually no symptoms before the scan, and at least 4 weeks after the scan, so we wanted to make sure we didn't hit them as they switched. But most were even much longer than that. And most had been off meds at this point for months. Because again, this takes 3 years on average for that second episode. Most of them, by the way, went on and had a second episode. But at this point they hadn't. And so we got them and we compared them to healthy subjects from the same general parts of the city. And they did this task. What time is it actually? I want to make sure I don't run too long. 1:45. I'm on Eastern time still, so I keep confusing myself. All right. So here's the task, and it's a simple task. You see flashing numbers. Your job is to hit a button whenever the same number occurs twice. In the scanner, it's a little harder than this because it's loud. Have you ever had a scan? It's cold, it's tight. But it's still generally pretty easy and no more annoying than I just was, right? And so we do that for about 10 minutes, and I forget the total number, 100 samples and a bunch of repetitions. And then we see how you've performed. And it's all done with these goggles we have where anything I can show you on a computer, I can show you in these goggles. So during long scans, our kids watch movies. And we once in a while have trouble getting kids to come out of the scanner because the movie's not done. And so this is what we see. So remember, we have these healthy subjects. They're young adults and late adolescents. They're from the same neighborhoods. Their education's the same. None of them are on medicines. None of them are having mood symptoms. And so their performance on the task is virtually identical. The bipolar patients showed a little more impulsive responding, but not enough to be significantly different. But overall, they look like just a sample of the same group of kids cut in half. So what would you expect when you compare their brain activation? Well, if this process is correct, you would expect no differences because there's no behavioral evidence that they're different. But in fact, they're quite different. So in this, these are brains. Again, for those who aren't imagers, they're cut kind of the long way. Front of the brain is here. Back of the brain is here. And the green areas are areas where the bipolar folks showed greater activation during this task than the healthy kids. So does anybody know what this brain region is? That's the amygdala. That's where it sits. So amygdala here. Then these are those ventral prefrontal cortical areas we talked about that modulate and manage the emotional response from the amygdala network. This is actually hypothalamus, but I still to this day don't believe that's really true. But if it is, it's just an amazing finding, but I don't believe it because it's so hard to see, but that's where that is. And so this combination of things here tells us that during this non-emotional task, our bipolar kids are having this emotional response to the task, and their prefrontal cortex is revving up to accommodate for it. It's trying to get that back under control, right? Because the brain's saying, wait a minute, this is not an emotional, dangerous situation. Calm that back down. Now, I mentioned you could imagine that maybe bipolar kids just really hate numbers, and so this is their response, but I think that's probably not true. The second piece is then there's all this posterior stuff. And these parts of the brain will typically come in online with any of you if I give you an attentional task and then progressively make it harder. Eventually, you're going to start recruiting these accessory visual and attentional areas to manage a difficult task. And so what it tells us is during this task, kind of at baseline, our bipolar kids with no symptoms, off meds, doing generally well, have excessive activation going on in their emotional brain that they're compensating for effectively at the moment, which is how you could explain their euthymic. The problem with this is when you already are recruiting your accessory brain to manage a low-stress, non-stress situation, that you're very vulnerable for that to collapse under increasing difficulty and stress. And there are some other studies that show that bipolar folks do well at these tasks, but as you make the task harder, they fall off faster than healthy folks. They run out of accommodation. And so we think this is the setup for putting you at risk for recurring affective episodes. So now you throw on some drugs or drug abuse or some stress or other events or more progressive loss of some structural pieces of your brain, your accommodation's going to fail, and boom, you have your second episode. And then more of it happens again, and boom, your third comes faster. Pretty soon you settle into a long-term course. Just interestingly, these are harder to believe, but this part of the brain in healthy people typically comes online as part of the way to disrupt this interference, and in fact isn't coming online in the bipolar. So there's multiple components, not managing the emotional brain's interference with the cognitive brain.
There's no difference on the baseline scan before the task?
No, again, the problem with fMRI is you can't ever have a pure nothing. But no, I mean, if the structural scans look fine, there's subtle differences, some of what we showed you before, and the performance looks fine. And so it's really, and this is a simple task. Harder tasks, you see different things because the patients will fall off much faster. We're not the only ones that have seen this excessive amygdala response. It's been seen a number of times in adults and kids. This is the typical amygdala stimulus isn't numbers, it's emotional faces. Again, thinking back to what we talked about of what's the most dangerous and rewarding thing in your environment, if you are heavily wired to pay attention to how other people are expressing feelings. Again, why? Well, if your back's to everybody and they all look scared, you probably want to turn around, right? So the axe murderer doesn't just axe you while your friends all watch. I've always said, when I scuba dive, I don't have to be faster than sharks, just faster than my buddy, right? And so if I notice my buddy's scared, I want to be responsive. So that always does, and it's always overactivated, almost always, not every study is the same, in bipolar folks. Medications may affect that. It may blunt that at some level. But if there's symptoms, the medications don't seem to matter much. Anyway, this study from Yale, I forget where they are, Pittsburgh, so it's all around the country. So as we think about this, so in these euthymic kids, the reason they've managed is that even though their sort of base network's overactivated, their prefrontal cortex is over-responding to manage it, right, so that they keep them euthymic. So what happens if your prefrontal cortex fails to do this job? Well, it turns out that during mania, suddenly we see a loss of the connections and response. So amygdala activating, suddenly there's a loss of response in ventral prefrontal cortex. Actually, I'm a slide ahead, sorry. This is a study, these are a bunch of studies, including ours, that show during mania, as opposed to euthymia, you see decreases in ventral prefrontal regions, decreased activation in response to a wide variety of tasks, suggesting that a manic person's prefrontal cortex is not coming online as effectively as a non-manic person's. Did you need an imaging study to know that? Of course not, right? You know, run naked down the street, and it's like your prefrontal cortex probably isn't working. But this demonstrates that you can actually see it. Yeah, I got ahead a couple slides, so ignore the previous stuff. I'll come back to it. This was an overly complicated study we did that I think I'm going to skip for time. Mainly to show, though, I'll show a little bit of it. So this is the anterior limbic network again, and we restricted this study to try to just look at the network. One of the things I've been pushing as an editor of one of the journals that manages neuroimaging is to get away from these 3D fishing expeditions where we look at every voxel we can and claiming we're testing hypotheses, because by definition, that's not hypothesis testing when you're doing everything, right? And so we tried to put a mask on this study where we forced only to analyze the anterior limbic network, and in the process of publishing this, it got completely beaten down and we ended up having to do the whole thing. So as we do imaging, though, we want to try to move away from these fishing expeditions to test hypotheses. And our goal was to actually test this network to see if it's abnormal. And this was a complicated task, and it turned out probably to be more complicated than we wanted because we're still trying to understand what it means. But this was developed at Duke, I believe, to try to separate the ventral and dorsal prefrontal components to stimulus management. And so there's just the baseline fixation. Then most of the time you see a bunch of squares, and periodically 10% of the time you see a circle. Circle's your target and you're supposed to respond and press a button. Then 10% of the time there's neutral pictures, which you can't see, but that are supposed to be non-threatening. So if you don't like buses, though, that's a scary picture, right? But we assume most people don't have emotional response to a bus. And then there's this creepy picture that I'm not even sure what it is, that's supposed to be a negative emotional picture. Those are just interspersed in here, but you're not supposed to respond to them as a target. They're just more background, just like squares. And the notion is that your ventral brain's going to pick up those emotional things, and in an event-related fMRI thing, you'll see that. You'll see activation. And indeed, that's true. In healthy people, the ventral brain focuses on these, and the cognitive brain focuses on that, just like you'd expect. Okay. And then this is some of the results, and part of why I always hesitate to present is because it's so confusing. But these are in clusters, if you can think about it. So the first three in each brain area are the bipolar ones, so the gray tones, grayish, that makes sense. So, or I mean the healthy, so healthy, healthy, healthy. All you're going to do here is, this is like playing chess. You're not planning your moves, you're looking at patterns. Right, good chess players don't really plan, they pattern respond. And then this is the bipolar folks. And so circles are first, that's the circle target. These are neutral pictures. These are emotional pictures. So if you look at a healthy response, you get no amygdala response to targets because it's not all that emotional. You start getting some emotion response to neutral pictures because you're partly from complexity, partly trying to figure out what it is. And then you get the most robust response from the emotional pictures. The bipolar, we get an interesting response where the general pattern's preserved, but there's an excessive response at baseline consistent with what we thought before, and then the whole thing is blunted. And what we think that means is there's an overactive system all the time, and so you have a restriction on how you can respond, and so it makes you, in some ways, have a less flexible emotional system. Does that make sense? And so some of this overactivation is just activating baseline, but you don't have the flexibility of healthy. And you'll see the same thing in a fusiform, the prefrontal cortex, and then there's this bizarre response in the cingulate to neutral pictures, or it's just reversed. Again, the cingulate typically shows a flat response because it has to process everything. And the patients, for some reason, it has trouble with that. So anyway, just look at the patterns. You can see that throughout the network, there's an abnormal pattern of responding in the bipolar folks. And the point of that is, again, this notion we can localize bipolar disorder is probably flawed. It's going to be a system response that's not working right. This is just, what does this mean? This is one of my favorite studies we've ever done. Jose mentioned that I had a couple hundred publications. I think about four of them are interesting. And this is one of them, and my graduate student did this, actually, Glenn Getz, who still sends me a Christmas card every year. So if you're a graduate student, send your mentor a Christmas card every year. It really does mean a lot. It really does, because you guys disappear. We never hear from you again. Anyway, sorry. This is looking at facial affect. So these are computer face recognition tasks, and so here all you're doing is saying, yes, that's a face. It'll get turned upside down. It's still a face. Turn side, well, it's still a face, and you got to be able to say that. The bipolar folks are red and the healthies are yellow. That's my typical thing. And these are clinically stable, generally euthymic bipolar patients compared to similar healthy volunteers. Both groups have no trouble recognizing that's a face. Okay, so I can see that's a face. But if you have bipolar disorder, even though you're doing pretty well, you still have a hard time labeling affect. So you're not sure if that's a sad face or a happy face or an angry face. And so where does this come from? Well, again, if you think about, so you have an overactive mood system all the time, you're compensating for it. In order to manage other people's emotions, you have to be able to kind of empathize and interpret what that face might mean. If it was your face, how would you interpret it? And because the system's disrupted, they can't do it. They struggle with it. Clinically, my anecdotal experience with this is I treat a lot of bipolar folks. I don't know if you do, anybody? Yes, no? So you'll get them symptom-free and think, we've got it. And then they go and just make series of stupid interpersonal decisions, even though they're having no symptoms. Is anyone else, it's just me and my bad therapy, right? And I think there's lots of different reasons for that, but one is if you constantly misinterpret emotional cues from people around you, you're going to have problems interpersonally. And so when I work with patients, I like to show them this slide because this is a great setup for working on your cognitive behavioral homework, right? Because you have to learn how to cognitively manage the fact that you may not be adept at interpreting what other people are feeling. And this may keep you from dating the loser that you met at the bar or getting in a fist fight when you thought someone was giving you a present, right? I mean, you got to learn how to do that. There have been lots of evidence that, as I mentioned, emotional faces light up the amygdala. And during mania, this is a study that Laurie Altschuler's group did. And it's hard to see. There's a couple little dots on here. But in bipolar manic folks, you see an overactivation. That's actually easier to see. An overactivation in the amygdala, that's what that is, without the corresponding activation in the ventral prefrontal cortex. In healthies, you see the opposite. The ventral prefrontal cortex comes online and kind of keeps everything under control so that you're not weeping in the scanner, right? So that you're managing it as a cognitive task. So somewhere in the process of mania, there's a disengagement of the normal prefrontal modulation of this lower emotional system. And we think that's what's underlying mania, that there's a functional loss. The prefrontal cortex hasn't been cut off from the rest of the brain, but it's not managing the brain well. In fact, we know that when you cut off the prefrontal cortex, you don't get manic, you get profoundly apathetic. We learned that in the 40s when we did prefrontal lobotomies. And so it's not simply that it's gone, it's not interacting and functioning with the emotional system anymore. And this is just some work we've recently done that we're still in the process of cleaning up. So we looked at this directly. So we have a large project going on, a first episode, early course, and at-risk kids. And these are within subject comparisons. So we have people, when they show up manic, we treat them, they go into remission, and we scan them at intervals throughout that process. So we can look at how symptom changes associate with how brain activation changes. And so this is a functional connectivity study where we're using the right amygdala as a seed region. So we start there, and then we look at what are the brains that the time series correlates with what we see in the amygdala, and then that will show up as orange. And the brighter they are, the more active. So yellow is very bright. So of course, the amygdala strongly correlates with itself. That's all this says, this blob. And so that's what we expect. And then during the manic phase, we see some other random associations around the brain. Who knows what they mean? But there's a big hole up here. Where's that ventral prefrontal response to this active amygdala? As they recover and become euthymic, the prefrontal cortex comes back online and the connections are restored. So again, it's not physically being reconnected because you're not growing new neurons during an 8-week period. You just can't. But whatever functionally keeps this part of the brain communicating with this part gets disruptive during mania and recovers during euthymia. And so we think that's the underlying basis for at least the manic phase of bipolar disorder. I actually think the depressive phase doesn't have unique physiology, but is a nonspecific response to the injury from mania. That's what I think. But I'm still working on demonstrating that. All right. Questions about the functional brain. So we see that there's structural abnormalities in this network. We see that there's functional abnormalities that correspond. And we're building this story that there's something wrong with how the prefrontal cortex integrates into the emotional system in bipolar disorder that leads to a recurring affective illness. And so lastly, I'm going to talk then a little bit about magnetic resonance spectroscopy. So with structural imaging and functional imaging, at some level, we're doing really cool phrenology, right? So we found where in the brain things are going wrong. And that's okay, because you have to start somewhere. But we still don't understand what's going wrong. And so what spectroscopy allows us to start doing is ask neurochemical and molecular questions of, okay, so we have this disengaged prefrontal cortex, what happened? Why is it doing that? And I told the old joke about the street lamp, but we're looking for the quarter where the light is, and it's the same thing now, right? So you all, I think, you have some spectroscopists around here, and so this is actually a fairly crappy old signal from some 1.5 I pulled off years ago. But in spectroscopy, for those who don't know, you focus on a region of the brain. And the way to think about MRI in the end is it's really a fancy radio station, and so your molecules function as little radio transmitters, and you can jazz them up with different types of energy and get different channels set out. And by focusing your what you're receiving, you can measure different things. And in this case then, unlike measuring oxygenated hemoglobin, which we did earlier, we're now measuring basically hydrogen concentration as it's associated with different kinds of structures, and so that's all it is. You can measure phosphorus this way. We have some studies going where we're looking at ATP concentrations in the brain using this technique. So it's really, truly a powerful technique. And those who went to medical school or biochemistry, remember the old organic chemistry class with the NMR spectrometer where you put a little test tube in and it gave you something, looked something like this, although it was, the lines were cleaner because there wasn't skull and stuff in the way, and then you were supposed to tell what it was, but because you went to psychiatry, you copied off your neighbor, right? Remember those things? So we all did that. All right. So there have been a series of studies, whoops, that's always a good trick, that suggested that there's something going wrong in the metabolic processes in the prefrontal cortex of bipolar disorder. And so this is one that we did, I guess, Kim Cecil at Children's. Again, comparing healthy subjects, bipolar subjects, my red, yellow standard. And this is using proton spectroscopy, looking at NAA, N-acetyl aspartate. So what is that? That's a very common neurochemical that serves a lot of functions, but one of its primary ones is a reservoir to allow creation of other neurotransmitters. It's an energy reservoir, particularly for glutamate creation. But it's also directly correlates with the amount of neuropile you have, and so it also does that, which is a confound. Choline is typically bound in membranes, and the numbers often change with turnover, which means there's membrane turnover. Those are the main ones I'm going to talk about. And then inositol is a neurotransmitter that you're aware of. In this study that Kim did, we compared these neurochemicals between the two groups and found that NAA was low, and I don't know where the error bars went, but they disappeared. And so is choline. The effect size is reasonably high for a behavioral study, about 0.41. A number of people have shown this now. What we don't know from this is it because there's just less brain? We've already talked about that there's less brain in the prefrontal cortex, and so that could completely explain less NAA. Or is it that there's a metabolic disruption, and so the NAA is being drawn off and the values have gone down? And so we examined that by combining it with treatment. So we like to use treatment as not only a way to get our patients better, but as a probe. And so we gave olanzapine in this case to adolescents with mania. And we compared those who responded, and then these are small, the non-responders. This is supposed to be day 7, not 78. I've had this slide for 10 years and never have fixed that. And so we looked at differences and changes in NAA over time. And during the first week, there's not much of an effect. But then during the first through fourth week, which is when you see the antimanic effects of these drugs, in fact, the responders' NAA levels statistically went up. And the non-responders statistically actually didn't change. There's enough error that it stayed flat. And so it suggested that there's a recovery of NAA stores as you respond to treatment. Now, could it be that during that 8-week trial they grew more glia neurons? Maybe. It's not real likely because that's not how fast this stuff grows. The more likely story is when this is effective, you restore metabolic processes, and since this means you probably decrease the glutamate, which I'm going to show you in a minute because that's what it does, and so you stop drawing off your NAA pool and you're able to restore your reserves, as it were. And so this is evidence that this is an evolving, changing process and can't all be explained just by loss of neuropile. This is a very good study that Steve Dager and Perry Renshaw did a number of years ago. Looked at depressed bipolar patients. Bipolar is red, healthy is yellow. Looked at the same kinds of metabolites, but this time they looked at GLX, which is a mixture of glutamine, glutamate, some GABA. Although in the prefrontal cortex where this was done, it's mostly glutamate, actually. And they've reported this, which is now well established, this elevated glutamate level during a depressive phase in bipolar disorder. Now, one of the interesting things that has been found out is glutamate goes up during depression, but it also goes up during mania, and it's only in euthymia that it's not up. And so, again, we are increasingly suspicious that the neurophysiologic processes of mania and depression are probably the same. And so we are now trying to figure out, so why are you in a pole or not? And we don't know the answer to that. The other interesting finding they found was that there was an increase in lactate. So why is that interesting? So we all know about lactate in muscles because we all exercise every 3 or 4 weeks trying to get back in shape, and then we get sore, and then we remember why we hate exercise, and so we wait again. So that's lactate, and muscles are prone to types of metabolism because they quickly exceed the oxygen that can be pumped to them, and so they go to anaerobic metabolism, and that's what produces lactate. The brain, that's typically not true. The brain, as I mentioned, is oversupplied with oxygen, and so you really have to work the brain to get lactate to be produced. We can do it. I could take any one of you and flash, put you in front of flashing lights, and eventually you'd either have a seizure or you'd start producing lactate or both, and so we can do it, but it's hard. And so lactate levels tend to be low. But in the bipolar folks, they've been elevated, and they were elevated. And this has now been shown several times that we have this excess of glutamate, usually a decrease of NAA. In this case, that's not true. And increase in lactate that suggests there's a hypermetabolic process going on that may be inefficient and is relying is leaving oxidative phosphorylation and going to anaerobic metabolism producing lactate in the bipolar brain. So Perry Renshaw and Stork wrote this very, very nice article. And if you are interested in this at all, I can't over-recommend this. It's one of the, one of the few truly seminal papers in psychiatry. There are lots of people who claim to have seminal papers. This is one of three, right, that truly are. And what they did is they looked at all the spectroscopy data available that looked like it was all over the place. It was very hard to interpret. But then they put together a story, and they found that this decreased ATP and decreased phosphocreatine and decreased pH, big lactate, high glutamate, shift towards glycolysis, energy storage problems, all of it can be explained by an inefficient mitochondrial process where you too quickly abandon oxidative phosphorylation for anaerobic metabolism for whatever reason. And you know, it could be, Perry and I have talked about this, it could be an inherent flaw at the mitochondrial control level because the mitochondria themselves probably aren't abnormal. Or it could be that you have an over-energized or over-activated part of the brain like the occipital cortex with the flashing lights that just overdrives the system, and so it ends up resulting to this. And I don't think we know which. But I think the evidence ultimately suggests there's some failure in how energy is managed in at least in the prefrontal cortex of people with bipolar disorder. And this is, again, a sloppy or very hard slide to see. Christine Conradi with Francine Bennis group wrote this paper. But they looked at brain slices of people with bipolar disorder, healthy, and schizophrenia. And again, small numbers, that's always a problem. And the anything here that's blue is where mRNAs suggesting downregulated genes of that product. So all these blue products are downregulated in the bipolar folks, but not in the other two groups. And it turns out these are all mRNA and genes managing oxidative phosphorylation and ATP-dependent processes. So looking at these brains posthumously suggests that the bipolar patients show a pattern of downregulation of these metabolic processes. It's unclear, again, it's not been possible yet to identify a mitochondrial genetic lesion that explains it, although the Hopkins group, Jimmy Potash and Ray DiPaolo, have some data of a maternally inherited bipolar disorder that would completely fit this, because if you remember, mitochondria are completely inherited from your mom, right? And so you would expect bipolar disorder, if it was a mitochondrial gene, to just occur down the maternal line, and we know that's not true because it also occurs on the paternal line. But it's possible there's direct genetic causes, or there's other reasons, other indirect epigenetic control processes, all of which end up with the same problem. You've downregulated these genes that control these energy processes, and now you have a prefrontal cortex that can't either energize itself appropriately in response, or can't respond or function in line with an overactivated emotional system, and so you end up failing. Does that make sense? And so that's kind of how we think about bipolar disorder these days. And so back to our emotional thing. So we've got, this always moves on me. So we've got the iterative networks, this thermostat, which itself may be flawed, glutamate pouring through here. These processes are metabolically abnormal, and the colored boxes are where we've seen abnormalities. It disrupts cognition, leading to cognitive symptoms. It disrupts output to the hypothalamus, leading to the abnormalities in the physical expression of emotion. And all of this contributes to unregulated or underregulated emotional states that cause bipolar disorder. In the end, we talked about this at lunch today. If you're going to commit your life to something and you spend more time at work than you do sleeping, right, which isn't fair, it really isn't, it should be something interesting. And so what's more interesting than this? And one of my favorite, you know, the brain, in my opinion, is the single most complicated thing in the universe. So if you're going to commit your life to understanding something, this is more interesting than ERA statistics and baseball cards, right? The other is interesting too, but this is something where we really have to challenge ourselves. And one of my favorite things to think about is to really understand things, I have to be able to get back from it. The fact is you can't get back from your brain because your brain is thinking about your brain. And so that presents with this interesting epistemological conundrum for the philosophers in the crowd to think about. Can we ever get enough distance to understand it? The bipolar brain, again, we're starting to understand it. There's been a fair amount of consensus that we've got this ventral prefrontal loss of control of the emotional brain, probably with a metabolic basis in the prefrontal cortex, if not everywhere. And so now the next step is to understand what are the lesions that cause this and how can we refine our treatments to start impacting the lesions directly so we can prevent the progression of illness over time. With that, I'm going to stop and take any questions. So thank you. Nice to have 15 minutes.
Thank you, Steve. That was really very interesting. So I'm going to just push you a little bit to speculate more. And on you've shown these three convergent sets of data, you know, overactivation in a more or less specific a network, yeah, that you call ventral emotional network. And then you've shown also some metabolic findings with spectroscopy that suggest, a deficit in energy metabolism. And you've also shown, you've not emphasized this so much, is the progressively enlarged ventricles. Mm-hmm. Now that's a diffuse finding. I mean, the ventricles are getting large. So how do you put it together, specifically the localized network with the enlarged ventricles and then the underlying process, metabolic process that could account for this diffuse enlarged ventricle?
So that's a great question, and I have no problem wildly speculating, so that's never stopped me before. So we think there's at least two possibilities that we think about. One is that this, again, remember the age period this is happening is one that's is an intense prefrontal emotional development. That's what teenagers are doing, right? Their job is to learn how to manage impulses to enter an adult world. Again, with the chimpanzee brains, ours are my parents, they're not going to do it smoothly, so don't take it personally, right? They're going to be erratic. But that process, given the way the brain works, is there's these loops that are going to require predictable responses from other parts of the brain to guide each one as they grow. So it's not like the amygdala is programmed to do one thing and the ventral prefrontal cortex is programmed to do another thing. They're working back and forth, refining how, from experience partly, right? Refining how you respond to emotional and cognitive challenges. And so one way to think about it is if the metabolic processes there don't allow that to happen smoothly or there's disconnections happening for one reason or another during that process, that developmental abnormalities continue throughout that course of life until you're finally 27 or 8 and you've settled down into your adult brain till you get older and everything goes down the tubes, right? The alternative that we've also thought of, so it could be just the natural course of a disrupted development, that if I disrupt development this way, I end up with an unpredictable mood states. The alternative that we wonder about, and I like this because it's cleaner, but I don't like it because I don't believe it. So there's a lot of thinking that glutamate is neurotoxic, which is true if you pile enough of it in, but I think generally we imagine our bodies and brains have been built so that we're not poisoning ourselves every time we use glutamate. But you could posit that if you have an unrestrained system that's metabolically abnormal, and so you're getting focal glutamate excess in these key parts of the brain, then maybe we're knocking out cells, losing the white matter tracts, so now the ventricles start growing because we're losing some of our physical connection. And so over time, we see loss of white matter and progressive ventricular enlargement, decreasing prefrontal cortical volume, and increasing loss of management of the mood so that we finally, again, settle into this state where we have recurring episodes every year. It's a nice story, too, I think. My worry is there's been much made of these glutamate excesses, but again, I think the brain does a good job generally of protecting itself from injuring itself, and so it's hard to know if that can really happen. But does that make sense? So those are the two things we think about. If I had to bet money, you know, you said, well, bet your house, which is it going to be? I'd say it's probably neither, but I suspect it's likely still part of the developmental process, or maybe the more accurate answer is both. It may be that in some patients it's part of that, and maybe in older patients it's the latter. And then you pile on drugs and alcohol abuse and other things, you might be able to accelerate damaging your brain and cycling faster.
The network that you postulate is a ventral network, and the connections are ventral.
Right.
What's really growing over time are the lateral ventricles, way up.
Right.
I mean, so how do you square that?
Well, then again, though, we see losses throughout the prefrontal cortex, and with that reciprocal connection, you're almost certainly disrupting dorsal prefrontal processes also. And maybe that's even the more prominent, that if our emotional network's out of whack, as the dorsal prefrontal cortex starts also providing inputs into these networks, those are abnormal, so you have loss of dorsal prefrontal controls. And there's some evidence that depression is more of a cognitive network, is a more dorsal injury, and so it could be that that's part of what leads to the depressive illness that's so prominent in bipolar disorder. So mania defines it, but people spend most of their time with mania. But I don't know the answer. Those would be the kinds of things I'd think about, though. A couple of good stories I suspect they're both wrong, and it's more difficult than that, but it's a good question.
A lot of the structural deficiencies in there are surrogate markers that you're deriving from metabolic effects.
Right.
What's the correlation between an actual structural deficit and the kind of imaging metabolically derived?
Right. So in the end, again, my suggestion was there's injury or damage that's causing these structural changes. The structure itself. So one of my favorite findings in my life is when I first started this 25 years ago. We were blindly looking at healthy subjects and bipolar folks. And the subject came through and schizophrenia too, I think, if I remember right, because the first episode's psychosis. And the subject came through with these absolutely enormous lateral ventricles. I mean, they were huge. It's like this teeny thin rim of cortex. And we thought, oh my God, this is a patient with schizophrenia. Well, it turned out to be a completely healthy Harvard student, right? And so part of that is to say, there isn't a direct correlation in a necessarily with a given among a group of people with the size of a brain region and the behavioral correlate that's thought to be associated with it. Although women know that because their brains are smaller, but they'll tell you that doesn't mean anything, right? And so, as Nancy Andreessen, who's about this tall, always likes to remind us. So I think it tells us that if you look at a group, there's something wrong with this group and how they developed. But it doesn't necessarily yet tell us what the problem is. And that's yeah, exactly. And I don't think it provides a measure of severity. And now, what may be more useful, which is what we're trying to do, is, and I think this is probably true, that changes in volume within a subject are going to be far more meaningful than absolute volume, because the range in humans is so wide that it's hard to distinguish. That's why people always ask me, why can't we now use this to make diagnoses? And the problem is, because the range in humans is so wide that it's hard to pull them apart. But it may be that we learn how to do trajectories and changes, we may then be able to diagnose a kid, right? So we have an ADHD kid and a bipolar kid, and one amygdala went this way and one amygdala went that way in a year, maybe we have a diagnostic marker. So that's the problem with structure, is it doesn't have a direct correlate to anything, really. I mean, we know if it's gone, right, then it's a problem. But other than that, it doesn't. But it's a good start. It's what we could do at the time.
The difference is, while they're statistically significant, don't really speak to an effect size.
No, they're hardly over. I can tell you what the effect sizes are, because we do. They range from 0.5, 0.6 to actually some as high as 1.5. I mean, their imaging does get some very robust effects compared to much of the rest of psychiatric research. And it depends on, so that ventricle finding was a robust effect because there was no overlap where the mean of the multiples was above everybody in the first group, everybody. There wasn't a single patient that even made it to the mean. So there can be some high ones, but even that doesn't get us to being able to use it individually. And there are people running around saying you can do SPECT and fMRI and making diagnoses. There's a guy who writes lots of books who you know, and that's snake oil. It is absolutely not true. And so at this point, we can't make diagnoses yet, but I think that we talked about this at lunch. I think the biomarkers we're looking for are changes in response to things. So response to lithium probe development, and those are going to be what we ultimately end up using to say, wow, we saw this change in the amygdala in the year in this kid with a bipolar family, they're at risk, right? Whereas his brother who normally developed isn't at risk. So I think that's the place for us to go next.
Just following up on the conversation we had before, we're talking about like differentiating between bipolar with psychosis, bipolar without psychosis, and thinking that some of the genetic studies basically co-segregate bipolar with psychosis with schizophrenia, right? Yeah. But yet there's not that much in the literature in terms of like looking at those things, and so in terms of like talking about biomarkers or endophenotypes or whatever, what do you think about, you know what, I've been thinking about it, what do you think about like, would the mechanism be the same, similar kind of mechanism, like for example when lack of filtering or not filtering well, what else could be involved? Would it be the same mechanism, would it be something different?
In bipolar patients versus schizophrenia?
Right.
Yep. So there's the problems I struggle with. I think the short answer, they could. I think they're probably, so if we look at P50 gating, for example, that ultimately it ends at the same place. And so at some point, even if it's a different starting point, a common mechanism is reached, right? So that makes sense. The struggle we have is we don't have any way to truly break a bipolar, psychotic bipolar group and a schizophrenic group apart. So using symptom constructs, there's no points of rarities where suddenly these groups diverge, right? And so in any study we do, Sam still here, he may have left, but we were talking about, so we talked about this morning. So when I have a schizophrenia research group, because we're trying to fill our studies, they're not completely certain, they'll typically include it. And so their bipolar patient sample is going to be this pristine bipolar group that they're not going to study because they're a schizophrenic group. And we do the opposite, right? If we call someone schizophrenic, by God, you are. We don't study them either. And so there's this mix in the middle that prevents us from being able to cleanly separate the groups and is always going to introduce noise. So that's the first problem. And I think that's the struggle with a lot of these genetic studies. Is that noise gets introduced. That's why when we talked about today using something like lithium response instead, manic with lithium response is not schizophrenia. It just isn't, almost by definition. So now you at least cleaned up the one group. The schizophrenia group's still going to have bipolar folks who've made their way in there because they've been chronically ill, but you'll narrow the noise down. So what endophenotypes might do is at least give us a quantifiable thing to measure. So you could look at amygdala trajectory as a predictor, or inositol increase with lithium as a predictor. I think those are the kinds of things that will ultimately be the way to separate these conditions. I think you're doing the right thing is looking at the groups and trying to understand it. but recognize there's going to be these problems that the groups aren't pure no matter what you do. And maybe looking at the extreme, that's why I liked your new aims better. With the non-psychotic group, you've got at least that group cleaner from the other. And now you can maybe determine, is there something in the NP group that picks out part of the P group, but not the other part that looks more like schizophrenia? Is that answering your question? I think I'm digressing. But it's a hard problem in the absence of...
if you want to make it more homogeneous, what you were suggesting was like you could... say you require two psychotic episodes or three psychotic episodes.
Yeah, you want to. My approach to this, which is against the spectrum notion, is to try to make to tighten your criteria. Again, your job DSM-4 is a and 5 are clinical coding documents. They're not research documents. And so for research, it's completely legit to start there and then say, but we're also going to require no psychosis, a family history of bipolar on this side, lots of psychosis, a family history of schizophrenia on this side, and then try to decide what you do with the middle group with bipolar psychosis. Good, maybe you require a family history of bipolar disorder or something. The problem it always becomes one practically of filling the study with enough subjects that you can do the work or not. But the more you can refine the groups to try to separate them, the better.
I guess the other thing that...
genetics is the opposite, by the way. They like to have lots of stuff because you're looking... In GWAS, you're trying to find associations among variably penetrant and expressed characteristics, and so there's a disadvantage to restricting. And so the two types of imaging genetics don't neatly meet there. That's one of the struggles, too.
The other thing we talked about is like... I mean, we're seeing... we're moving away from grappling, like basically like... with all this stuff in terms of like neurocognition in bipolar disorder is also not that good, especially with schizophrenia, and also disability related to that. So what thoughts do you get from that? What ideas do you get about similarities in the illnesses or is it or in the course in a certain way, or what makes the course different?
The classic thing is bipolar is recover, and so you could always restrict your samples that way. Where schizophrenia historically didn't think it recovered. Now, as we did these treatment trials, people disagreed about that, but at the same time, they loosened what they called schizophrenia and bipolar disorder, guaranteeing you're going to have one of both in each, right? You're right, the neurocognitive literature in bipolar disorder is not as strong, partly because I think the findings aren't as robust. And so you see some stuff sometimes, but it gets confounded by chronicity and drug and alcohol abuse. And if you can find patients where there's less of that, I think you see less impairment. Part of what we talked about this morning, I'm not a big fan of these generic neuropsychological tests because they are so not system specific that people can solve them many, many different ways, and so they don't distinguish things. And you really have to think about what are the specific cognitive measures and to develop a task just to look at cognitive measure. IQ is so vague, it's virtually meaningless. We know it predicts school performance, but it really doesn't predict anything else. So I think that's that. If I, as you tackle this problem, I think that's how I would think about it. Your schizophrenia has had a much larger funding base and a much bigger research pool than bipolar disorder for 50 years, and so bipolar trails in some areas. I think one of the few places we've made progress actually is here, and that's going to be one of the struggles you see when you try to get into our sloppy world. Good. Well, thank you all for sticking around.